Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be able to discuss the topic of Asian currencies with you. There is a number of factors that are driving the FX market right now, the key among them being the decline in the trend of commodity prices, the slowdown in China. But I would like to focus on the one that I think will be the most important, which is how the US Central Bank is going to operate in terms of tightening its policy stance and raising interest rates. So which currencies are prepared for interest rate hikes in the US? Who will do well and who will not do so well? What is the outlook for the FX market in our region? Let me first give you a couple of key takeaways. This will serve as a summary. I will then overview the fundamentals of Asian currencies and how they make them well or not so well prepared to a more restrictive monetary policy coming out of the US. Most Asian currencies have declined so far this year, despite the fact that Asian economies have maintained external surpluses and have been net recipients of large portfolio flows. The key reason is the strength of the dollar in global markets, in particular against the yen. And the outlook for the next couple of quarters is a function of growth in our key export markets, which is the US, the Eurozone, and China, the size of balance sheets and policy rates of G3 central banks and how they will impact the major currency performance, the direction of equities in the G3 markets, the direction of their sovereign bond yield curves, as well as geopolitical risks. We think that growth in the US will pick up next year, but slowdown in the Eurozone will continue. Japan will not do that well. The Chinese economy will also decelerate. At the same time, growth in the remainder of emerging Asia will pick up pace. And this means that current account positions of the regional currencies are likely to deteriorate. The Fed has already ended quantitative easing program. We think that the first rate hike will come in the third quarter of next year, which will lead to an outflow of capital from emerging markets, including in Asia. But this outflow will be partially compensated by inflows of funds from quantitative easing by other major central banks, in particular Bank of Japan and the ECB. The US dollar will continue to strengthen against major currencies, and this will weigh on Asian FX, but remember that all is relative and Asian currencies will appreciate against the Japanese yen and against the euro. There will be some geopolitical events that will probably continue to impact sentiment negatively, such as conflict in Ukraine. And overall, against the US dollar, we think that most currencies will continue to be under downward pressure. There will only be two that will rise versus the greenback, the Chinese renminbi and the Taiwanese dollar. So let's now move to analyze the fundamentals of Asian currencies so that we can have a better understanding why most of them will not do that well and why it is the Chinese renminbi and the Taiwanese dollar whose future is the brightest. First, let's look at external positions, the balance of payments metrics for Asia. As you can see on these two charts comparing how they looked before the great financial crisis of 2008-2009 and how they look right now, you can see that the sum of current account, direct investment and portfolio flows continues to be positive, but less so than before the Great Recession. Singapore and Taiwan look the most solid right now, while it used to be China and Malaysia. Outside of Hong Kong, which is pegged to the US dollar and protected by backstop from China, Indonesia looks the weakest, while it used to be that the most vulnerable one was Korea. Basic balances will provide a shield. Countries with large current account surpluses seem well insulated, and their currencies will not come under major downward pressure. Here, Singapore and Taiwan again appear solid, followed by Korea and Malaysia, but Malaysia and, in fact, China have deteriorated substantially, and Indonesia, as well as India, appear vulnerable. Portfolio outflows. Markets with large portfolio deficits, such as Singapore, are in a better position because typically, in times of large capital flows, money returns home, returns to countries that were origin of portfolio investments globally. Countries that finance basic balance deficits with portfolio inflows, such as Indonesia and India, or that have attracted a lot of those flows, such as the Philippines, are most vulnerable to outflows, simply because there is too much capital that have already made their way to them. But their vulnerability needs to be measured against their currency reserves. Those reserves can provide a major buffer against capital flows. And fortunately for our region, most Asian economies have increased their currency reserve buffers. As a share of GDP, Hong Kong, Taiwan, and the Philippines have seen the biggest improvement, while Malaysia and India have deteriorated the most. And India and Indonesia continue to suffer from the lowest level of these buffers. The key metrics here is the FX reserve coverage of potential outflows. For example, when you look at the FX reserve coverage of imports, it increased in the Philippines and declined in India. But when it comes to absolute levels, it's the highest in China, Taiwan, and the Philippines. FX reserve coverage of short-term external debt is even more important because this kind of debt will trigger flows at a time of US interest rate tightening that could impact the currency market. And here, we have seen major improvement in Philippines and Korea, but deterioration in India. In gross terms, in absolute terms, this coverage is the highest in the Philippines and China and relatively low in Singapore and Malaysia. We also look at FX reserve coverage of gross portfolio liabilities. It increased in Singapore and the Philippines, declined in India and Malaysia. It's high in China, while low in Indonesia, Korea, and Malaysia. When you look at the totality of potential outflows at a time of interest rate hikes in the US, and these outflows could include import payments, short-term external debt repayment, and portfolio liabilities, the composite coverage that currency reserves provide has increased the most in the Philippines while declining in India. It is in absolute terms high in China while low in Singapore, Indonesia, Malaysia, and Korea. Another buffer that countries enjoy is international investment position. It represents all the portfolio flows that have been accumulated by a given country. In net terms, it has increased and is high and positive in China, Taiwan, Hong Kong, and Singapore, while deteriorating again in Indonesia and in India. Analyzing all these metrics and how they impact the security of each currency against potential outflow of capital, we come to the conclusion that the only truly safe markets are Taiwan and China. And therefore, we see the Chinese currency, the renminbi, as a safe haven. The Taiwanese dollar is highly correlated with it and will also do fairly well. Those two will be outperformers. On the other hand, India and Indonesia and their currencies are the most vulnerable. In order to assess the level of vulnerability, we survey a number of indicators. One of them is gross performance, which remains superior in Asia versus other parts of the world, but is quite varied. For example, China, Malaysia, and the Philippines are currently growing at the fastest pace, while Thailand, Hong Kong, and Singapore are laggards. We also look at outlook for growth, especially growth of the manufacturing sector, which traditionally is the driver of economic cycles in the region. The regional manufacturing cycle is taking time to recover, more convincingly, because exports are relatively subdued. What we are particularly concerned about is the poor manufacturing PMI in China. There was, on the other hand, improvement in terms of both exports and manufacturing PMI in India. When you look at manufacturing and exports, Singapore and Thailand are laggards, but Indonesia is also not doing that well. Since we are discussing here portfolio flows, let's look directly at how they have performed and where valuations are attractive for portfolio capital. Equity valuations in Asia are relatively attractive. Pretty much all markets are cheap relative to the US. Only Taiwan is expensive. China, Hong Kong, and Korea are the cheapest, and they are also particularly attractive even compared to the valuations that these markets typically command, while Thailand, Taiwan, and the Philippines are relatively expensive. We think that equity inflows into the region will continue as long as S&P 500 rises and as long as US Treasury yields do not increase too much. It may be interesting to note that while Asian equity markets have been a magnet for foreign capital, Asian bond markets have attracted more funds. Certain markets have already seen monetary tightening, such as Malaysia and the Philippines, making their yields higher and relatively better placed to bring in foreign fund flows. Some have very high interest rates and yields in the government bond markets, especially India and Indonesia. And India in particular have been a recipient of huge amounts of money into their bond markets after Modi was elected. And many are attractive for further fixed income flows, especially considering how low yields are in the US and core Eurozone markets. When it comes to investing directly in currencies, which typically has to happen through the non-deliverable forward market, the NDF market, there is a lot of implied yield cushion that Asian currencies offer, and in particular, the weakest currencies, India and Indonesia, are well protected by high implied yields. Still, from the perspective of 12 months total returns, and the chart on the right-hand side shows our outlooks here, from the perspective of offshore investors, we favor the Chinese currency, the renminbi, the Korean won, Malaysian ringgit, and the Filipino peso. These are the currencies that we recommend to our clients in the next few quarters, and we would use the Singaporean dollar as a funding currency. Let's have a quick overview of individual FX markets, starting with China. In the short run, we are fairly bullish on the renminbi. We think it will appreciate because of strong exports, and these strong exports mean that the PBOC no longer favors depreciation. Investors have also become accustomed to life with a wider daily trading band, and corporates are reducing their currency deposit accumulation and converting FX inflows that they have to the renminbi in light of an improved growth outlook. In the long term, however, the renminbi will stabilize amid higher volatility as trade surplus and demand for internationalization will be matched by capital account opening, direct investment outflows, and lower investment demand for the currency as its volatility rises. CNH, the offshore version of the RMB, is our top pick due to the yield advantage, which here is higher for offshore investors than what is available in the CNY NDF market, and due to the low volatility, which makes the sharp ratio of investments in the CNH more attractive. It will trade at a modest premium versus the onshore CNY due to internationalization demand for portfolio investment, and a lack of intervention against the currency by the Chinese Central Bank vis-a-vis what's happening onshore when those interventions continue. Absolute returns are higher here than in case of the CNY. The Indian rupee is less unstable than it used to be, but still vulnerable. The new political landscape is favorable for macroeconomic turnaround, but the process will be longer than expected. Fundamentals remain quite shaky, in particular when you look at high inflation, large fiscal deficit, or huge short-term external debt. The INR is also highly exposed to portfolio capital outflows when the Fed starts raising rates. On the positive side, it does remain supportive by high interest rates in the onshore market. The Indonesian rupiah, fundamentally the weakest, but also the highest yielding. Political environment has improved since the election of Jokowi as president. inflation has come down, but will shoot up again soon as fuel subsidy cuts are coming. External position is the weakest in Asia, and the Fed rate tightening cycle is the major risk for the currency. There is some cushion from high interest rates, but probably not enough to protect the rupiah. The Korean won, a strong currency, but very volatile and vulnerable to weakness of the Japanese yen. The massive current account surplus that Korea is generating is providing good support. We have seen high foreign portfolio inflows from abroad. However, the Bank of Korea is intervening to depreciate the currency, at least partly in line with the weakening yen. Korea has a huge exposure due to a massive stock of foreign portfolio capital that has been accumulated. Malaysia, the ringgit has strong fundamentals. It's one of our top picks. Bank Negara is raising rates because of subsidy adjustments and goods and services tax that will be implemented that are set to push the inflation up. This will be supportive for the currency. It's also under upward pressure from current account surplus, which is on a rebound. The Filipino peso also enjoys strong macro fundamentals. It's one of the fastest growing economies in the region. The strong stream of remittances is underpinning the currency. We have seen rate hikes due to high inflation. And at the same time, because of the large stock of foreign portfolio investments accumulated in the country, upside is limited by exposure to what will happen with these investments when the Fed starts raising rates. As I mentioned, the Singaporean dollar is our preferred funding currency. Singaporean growth has slowed to a fairly tepid pace. Large-scale short-term external debt is a risk at a time of the Fed getting ready to tighten monetary policy. The basket mechanism that the Monetary Authority of Singapore uses to manage the Singaporean dollar means significant downside for the unit at a time of strength of the greenback in global markets. And very low interest rates make the Sing an ideal funding currency. So when you want to buy the attractive currencies in Asia, such as the renminbi, you can do it by borrowing the Singaporean dollar and selling it short. The Taiwanese dollar is riding on the China factor. We expect it to appreciate in line with the CNH. Taiwan has some of the strongest fundamentals in the region. In particular, when you look at the massive current account surplus and huge international investment position that the country has accumulated. However, upside is limited by central bank interventions as the Bank of China in Taiwan is trying to make sure that competitiveness of the island is not lost as Korea and Japan are experiencing currency depreciation. And finally, the Thai baht. It's a currency that is plagued by political vulnerabilities. We have a volatile political situation that has sort of calmed down recently, but knowing what can happen in Thailand, it remains a major risk. Growth of the economy, which was brought down by the domestic political issues, is on the rebound. We have an external position that has firmed up. There has been some foreign interest in Thai portfolio assets. By and large, we do not recommend any large exposure to this currency as a result of political vulnerabilities. So to sum it up, we have already seen depreciation of Asian currencies in the second half of this year as a result of investors fearing outflow of capital to higher yielding treasury market in the US. The US dollar strength has weighed on regional FX. And as we move into 2015, the year when the Fed will finally start raising interest rates in the third quarter of the coming year, the downward pressure on Asian currencies will continue, and it will be driven by capital outflows, and a lot of the countries in the Asian area have accumulated a lot of the capital that could flow back to the US. We think that there are two currencies that will withstand these kind of pressures, the Taiwanese dollar and most importantly the Chinese renminbi. And we recommend our clients to invest in the CNH in particular, as it offers more attractive yield than the CNY at a better sharp ratio. Thank you very much.